It is the drip god, the greatest 19-year-old wrestler in the world, Ronan King. And welcome to SWN.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always. Taking a couple of weeks break and I forgot my own intro. I am joined on this edition for this on-tour season. We're taking a little bit of a pit stop. I'm joined by the Lightning Bolt, Tommy Raiden. Welcome to the show.
Hello, how are you doing, Billy?
I'm excited. It's been a couple of weeks. The last interview, proper one I did, was probably the Day of Birth Bonanza, round about then, at the end of June. So I'm still recovering from that, to be honest. It was a bit of a wild time. But after that, of course, you know, just had a 2 minutes with Trinity and Naomi from so that's the same person. Trinity and Deonna Purrazzo from Impact Wrestling, you know, just to watch a show off or anything. But all well, how are you doing?
I'm doing pretty well, thank you very much.
So we've got you on the show. I put out a call for some guests, and Kirsten Louise, who does amazing photos, she put yourself and a guest who hopefully we'll have on next week. I don't know when it will be in the actual podcast averse, but next week hopefully we'll speak to Ollie Green. But she put your name forward along with Oliver, so we've got it sorted, we've got it done, we're here. So I'm assuming this is your first podcast you've done.
Yeah, pretty much is first time.
Excellent. I've popped a lot of podcast cherries for wrestlers in Scotland, and that streak continues. Yeah. The first question is the same for everyone, first time guests. It's a basic question you're probably going to get asked a million times in your wrestling career. How did you get into wrestling? So what was the moment you watched it and were like, yeah, this is cool, I'm into this?
Well, it's kind of a weird story because I got into wrestling pretty much around the age of 10, so roughly around 2012, when wrestling was in a bit of a, not in the best place. Personally, I thought I was all right at the time. It would mainly like just pop on the TV when my cousins used to come over, because they used to pop around and then we'd go to school together. So they liked what they were watching with 2012. Me, I just saw it as, it's there, just something on the TV. Rock and Cena was pretty much like the big thing at the time, like it was being advertised. And it was just, to me, it just felt like, okay, that's pretty much there. Don't know when it will be, but it'll be there. Heard the results, it's like, okay. And then my cousins had WWE 12 for the Xbox 360. And I was just going through these wrestlers. I'm like, okay, they're pretty cool. I see Undertaker, and I'm like, he's cool. I like the Undertaker. So I instantly just went, okay, he's a favorite of mine. And I was like constantly playing as the Undertaker. And then I just started to branch out into different types of wrestlers. And then I'd say roughly around a month or two later, I decided to further explore more of what WWE was doing, like back from the early 2000s to mid 2000s, and I just instantly hooked. Absolutely loved it.
That's a bit. So how old were you around about then? And I'm going to age myself terribly when you answer.
I think around 2012, I was roughly about 10.
Oh God! And you had at 10 years old, you were watching it going, oh, yes, it's cool, but I'm sure it was cooler before. I cannot relate with that. I was right about 2000 was when I was 10, so that was. Like Attitude Era, but so you're even then you were like, yeah, this is cool. Undertaker still making fans in 2012. Mm-hmm. That's ridiculous in itself. Yeah. And of course, the video games seems to be quite a common occurrence now for wrestlers that are that are around about your age. That seems to be the thing that's bringing a lot of people in. Which back in my day it was Channel 4. That's how old I am. So Undertaker, you went back in time a little bit beforehand with other, was it just DVDs, was it YouTube, network? I don't think network was a thing then, but like YouTube, and how did you kind of explore old wrestling?
I think it mainly started off with DVDs, and then later on just became this thing where I was just watching a lot of YouTube videos, and yeah, just instantly hooked. I actually remember when, I think it was 2012, and then Undertaker was on screen. I was like, oh my God, it's the Undertaker, so cool. And then I'm just like, in 2012, I'm like, where's the Undertaker? I want to see Undertaker. He's not there. And I'm like, oh, okay.
Wrestling sucks now.
Yeah.
Did you get the chance to go to like WWE Live? And I'm assuming you're kind of Aberdeen-ish based, being up in WrestleZone. So did you get to any of the shows when they were at the ACC or anything like that?
I think roughly around right at the end of 2016 when they announced that they were going to be heading to the AECC, cousin gave me a message saying, "Oh yeah, WWE is going to be at the ACCC." I'm like, "What?" So
Was
I had to buy
that
my ticket straight away.
is that AJ Styles Dean Ambrose main event?
Yes, it was. Yeah.
Yeah, I was at that one. That was ace. That was such a good night. That was yeah. Seeing like Randy Orton and that and all that kind of thing, that was a really cool show. And I don't know what it is about going to WWE shows particularly, because you can go to your local shows, which I love going to, but there's just something like atmospheric about going to WWE, even if it's an ACC. And just because you're there, you actually see the guys off the telly, and you're seeing the likes of your Orton, your AJ Styles, and I can't remember who else is on. Hype Bros, can't win them all, I suppose. But yeah, so it's really cool to go do that. So from then on, then started becoming a fan around about 10. Undertaker's taking a break. How did you go about becoming a wrestler then? So was it were you going to the shows in Aberdeen? Did you find to see a poster? How did that kind of come about?
Well, I think at first, once I got into WWE, it was kind of like the thing that's like, I just love watching it. I just what they're doing is just really, really fun. And then one day, I can't remember what happened, but I was just walking around, and then I see a poster for Ellen back in 2013, and I'm like, wait, they do wrestling in like Aberdeen and Ellen? Oh my God, I've got to go see it. And then I tell you, going to see that show in Ellen just changed me, because I was like, you know what? If they're gonna do wrestling in Scotland, then I want to be part of it.
I'm going to go find and see if I've got the card for that, because I'm more curious than ever. See, I like knowing who you guys see first. I've said see way too many times in that sentence. Because 2013, so I got into WrestleZone the year before. So there's quite a few names that are on there that won't be now, for good reasons. Like they've decided to pack it in, not for any other reasons. Right. This is thrilling for everyone listening. That I'm gonna go and look for it. Ellen. Let's see. Until I haven't done this for a few weeks, I'm just plodding my way through. Right, Ellen 2013. Okay, so we're looking at Johnny Lyons versus Blue Thunder. Fine.
That was a good
Right,
one.
Brian Starr versus Zach Dynamite. Not
Yeah.
bad. Scotty Swift versus James Midas, Golden. We had the Hot Shots against Sterling Isle. Oh, nice. That would have been great.
Yeah, that was good.
Aspen Faith versus Chris Archer, which, they're still going now. That's 10 years later. And Undisputed Championship match, Crusher Crave versus Damien. That, you know what? Ellen, it's so out the way that you think that they're just going to do a kind of a easy show. But that's a pretty banging card, to be honest, for an Ellen show.
I still remember, I think it was one of the first matches. When they were like hitting moves on each other and taking bumps, I was like, "Oh my God, that's loud! That's filling the entire room." And there's like occasions where I'm just like covering the ears, like, "Okay, I know what's coming."
Oh man, the Ellen venue is great. I mean, I've only been to one show. I went to one 2021. No, oh, I can't remember 2022. And yeah, it's a really nice. It's just a big hall. Easy to find. There's parking. That's at my age now. That's most important things when it comes to the venue, parking. And but no, the Ellen shows are not to be missed out on. They're often just ace. So WrestleZone arrived. You saw it. You wanted to be part of it. Was it just, did you have to wait before you could train? What was the kind of process from that point that you want to be involved? How'd you get there?
Well, I think it was around the time when this was like around the time when they announced the youth classes, and I was just messaging them like mad, saying, "Okay, when do I join? When do I join?" And it's like just constantly like giving them messages on like Messenger saying, "Would it be okay to join this day or whatever day?" And then I was like, "Oh, I don't know. I'll just wait till I'm 16." And yeah, when that time came, I just signed up to the training academy, finally, I still remember my first day because I remember someone sent me like a GIF of the Beatles, I think it was, and they were saying something like "Good luck" or something like that. And then my favorite part is when I just knocked on the door and no one answered, and I just opened the door and that was it.
The security is not as a bit of an issue there at WrestleZone.
Yeah.
But so that must be amazing. That so you're 16, you've watched wrestling for a couple of years now, well, at least five, 6 years. In that time, then were you a quote unquote backyarder? Were you doing stuff on the trampoline, in the garden with your mates and stuff like that? Was it always in your mind that this is what you're going to do as soon as you can, or
Yeah.
did you have a gimmick?
Yeah, I think around that time, I used to go to my mate's house and just wrestle on the trampoline, pretty much something like that. And I think we even had ideas on doing like random promos, but we never got them filmed, which just made the whole thing really, really funny. And I think there was occasion where I used to have like the replica World Heavyweight Championship. And but for I don't know what happened to it. I think it cracked for some reason. So I decided, like, you know what, I'll just make my own one. So I just take cardboard and then just put all these materials together, and then I just brung it to a friend's house, and I was just walking in town with the thing sticking out of my
Oh, the confidence of youth. Love it. I love it.
back.
It's, I mean, now that you've actually done the wrestling for a little bit, I'm going to guess that's not something you'd probably do now.
No. No, if I saw that, I'd just be like,
I know.
no, thank you. It's not me. I'm not that person.
That's it. When you go to the shows, I mean, you'll see it now. When you go to the shows, you see people in the crowd and they've got their belts. And there's part of you that goes, no, I wouldn't do that. There's also a part that goes, I wish I could though. I wish I could confidently just go, right, I'm the champ here. I've took my belt. I'm going to the wrestling. I think I did it a couple of times. Admittedly, way too old to do it. I was like 20. But yeah, I can't believe it. It's just that was the thought process going, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to go to the wrestling. I'm going to take my belt as well. That's a good idea. Because the thing is now, if you take a belt to a show, you have to defend it. That's the rules.
Yeah, it's true.
It's unwritten rule for everyone listening and watching that if you take a belt to a wrestling show, you've got to defend it. That's it.
Yeah. God, I wish I did though.
yeah, right. So what was your kind of character there? Was it always the lightning bolt in mind? Was that always there, or did you? What was it? Go on, you got
Oh,
it. Has to be
God.
embarrassing because mine was the bean, and that was terrible. So you
Oh,
had to.
no. This is actually kind of, it's actually gonna, I think the guys are gonna be watching this, but I have no idea. It was just pretty much just a random high flying character. And then I still remember this. At the time, I would always come out to this song called, I think it was called Growler. It was used in the Deadpool video game, like the title screen music. And I was like, that song's so cool. I wanna use that. But now I'm just like, thank God I'm not using that.
Oh, do you remember any of your promos? This is just now just a podcast me embarrassing you for the first 20 minutes. So yeah, any promos? Do you remember? Did you have a catchphrase?
No, not really. I think it was just like the random promos that just ended abruptly. It would be like, I'll see you then. That's it.
Fade to black. Used when it was Movie Maker. Fade. He laughs, but I that's why how I edit this podcast is Movie Maker. That's ridiculous. Anyway, so yeah, I don't know where to go from that there because I'm just more fascinated about your backyarding because everyone does it. We ignore.
Yeah.
Did you justify it in your own head when you say don't try this at home or at school? You're like, me doing it at home or at school, I'm doing it at my friend's house, so it's their responsibility at that point.
Yeah, it was more the thing whenever it was at school. I mean, at school, I didn't have a lot of friends that liked wrestling personally. Whenever I kind of put it out there, a lot of them were kind of like, oh, that's fake. Watch UFC instead. And at the time, I was kind of like, oh, okay. Now I'm just like, cool. But, yeah, pretty much. I mean, there was actually one person that actually, I mean, I got them into wrestling, and I think at the time, I think it was sports day. We were just walking to one of the fields, and then you'll probably know where this is going. And then he just comes from behind me and then just goes, and he's like, RKO out of nowhere. And I'm like, stop, just stop it.
We're cool. We're cool. The girls don't need to know we like wrestling. That's
No.
I like nowadays though, it is a bit more, people just accept it. I think it's more of a case of just let them be kind of thing, and you know, like wrestling, cool. That's pretty much the attitude. I hope it is nowadays in school as well. So that point onwards, you broke into the Wrestling Training Academy after messaging them constantly, and started your training. So you said you're always a high flyer. That was your character. Did you do any sports to kind of go with that? Were you any gymnastics or anything like that, or was it just a case of you just kind of kept yourself? You had that kind of young person metabolism, and were able just to.
I think I just had that young person metabolism type thing. I think most of it would have just come down to like school sports, PE, something like that, mainly.
How did you take to that first session then? Was it just basics rolls? What was your thoughts? Was there
I
any regrets at
think
that point?
my first session was just mainly like, oh, I could get this wrong. My memory's terrible. But I think the first session, I was just told that I would just be just be sitting and watching and just taking notes on what the others would be doing. And it was really, really fun and all that. But yeah, that was around the time when they had the ring room and the mats room weren't really connected at the time. It was mainly their own separate thing. And I was just mainly just and on the side, just watching and just taking notes of how it's done, pretty much.
And like I said, was there any regrets on that first bump, or was as soon as you hit it, you're like, yeah, this is what I'm doing.
I wish I just made some more noise because after that first bump, I was just kind of like, oh, Jesus. Oh.
Just a winded. It was
Yeah, I just winded. Like the first bump, it was like, oh, God. I'm trying not to look back. I'm just like, okay, no, don't look back. Don't look back. Don't look back. Okay, no, I'm back.
Is there anyone else in the class that's still going? Was like Ollie, or was anyone else right about the same time as you for starting?
I think there was like a couple of people that started roughly around the same time I did, but they went away. I don't know. I think I'd say Evan came in around the time I started, maybe. I'm not quite sure, but I think at that time there was Reese, Connor, and Caleb were like still trainees at the time. But I think that was around the time Caleb was about to be put on shows, or I think it was Ryan, I believe. Either one of the two.
Looking at about 2016, 2017, yeah, probably Ryan. I would say out of that, I think when Caleb was 2019, maybe something like that.
Think so.
Yeah, because it was just as because he was still his first Anarchy at 2019, so it must be tw end 2018. I know far too much about Caleb. I should probably just move on from there. So we've got loads of questions there. We'll go kind of through your journey a little bit as we go through it. Because a lot of these seem to be things of a bit more of your personality and things that I'm interested in diving into. But I'm just going to start with Rhys Dawkins, because his question is interesting in itself. How can you claim to be a lightning bolt when you're clearly, in fact, a regular human man?
Speed, just speed.
The speed.
Lots and lo lots of running, lots of running the ropes and stuff.
That's fine. So yeah, is that why you've chosen like the Flash kind of logo for your initial debut? Is that all encompassing, or was Omar trying to try and get you Lightning Queen gear? What was the any conversations regarding that?
Mean, I tried at one point to get Lightning McQueen gear, and he just went, "No, just no. That's his thing." And I'm like, okay. But I don't know with the Flash logo. I think originally it was just meant to be yellow without the white symbol, the white circle in the middle. But just originally I had like a like I before the I think it was Stonehaven last year, the Stonehaven Highland Games. I sprayed on a lightning bolt on like a random tank top, and looking back at it, it's kind of like it. Just does not look, it doesn't look good. It doesn't look good.
We've all got to go through the worst of it for before you can make it all get together. So the first time I saw you was Trinity Center Takeover. I was at the Trinity Center, obviously. I was just one of those free shows that they had in a corner of the Trinity Center, which is weird, 'cause walking into it, I was like, I wonder where the ring is. Turn the corner. Oh, there it is. There's the ring. That's fine. And that was kind of big day. I don't know if you did galas beforehand, but you were on the show like what, four times? You had four or five matches that day. So that's what, that's 2022. Yeah, 2022. Started 2016. So big pandemic in the middle. So that's probably what, 3, 4 years of training. When you found out you're actually getting to go on a show, was what was your initial thoughts? Did you think you were ready? Did you put away the yellow spray paint? What was your kind of reactions?
I think at the time, because I just got in the notification when I was doing a college course, because I think at the time we were on either on lunch, yeah, it was lunch, and I get a rant, and then I get a text message from the higher ups, and they say, "Did you know you're gonna be on the, did you know you're gonna be on the Training Academy show, and you're gonna be on the VIP match at Christmas?" And I was just, the moment I saw that, I was just like, "What?" And then I'm just reading the message like constantly saying, am I be, is this, oh my God. Yeah, it was just mainly coming down to, oh my God, this is actually happening type thing.
Yeah, and then let's say you went through quite a lot of, I think it was Murphy was one of your opponents. I do have the results somewhere. But you had quite a day of it in front of just randoms going past. Did you feel that was your you needed that as to get a lot of reps in one go, so you're ready for the Training Academy show, for your so you're ready for the Christmas Chaos, where it was just trial by fire, throw yourself into it.
Yeah, it was just pretty much the type of thing, just coming to training as much as I can, and then just be as ready as I am, pretty much.
So we do have a question regarding Trinity Center. So it's from Ronan King, one of your opponents on the day, because he put, how did it feel to get your head stomped in at the Trinity Center in front of everyone?
I mean, it wasn't pleasant, let's just say that. I don't know if it's going on as like the worst one he did, but I've taken worse from him. That's all I can say. The one at Trinity Center wasn't pleasant. Wasn't the best.
I mean, for your first overall show, you still had you were the journey of the day, because of course you had your first match, and then at the end of the show everyone kind of gathered for the big battle royal at the end, and you ended up winning that and do the big battering of Ronan King afterwards, after the show. So it must be a great feeling to having gone through things like the big stomp and go through all that Murphy and what have you to end the day triumphantly winning. Getting cheered on by everyone around about you. Must again, does it just cement your thoughts that like, this is worth it? This has been worth all these years, this pandemic as well. Was this all been worth it so I can get that moment?
It's been pretty amazing in all honesty. Like, I think after that battle royal, it was just like, oh God, I needed that feeling so much.
So Judas Grace offered a second question to go along with Ronan's, which is just want to help me jump Ronan King. So
Heck yeah, you know where I am. You know where I'm at. Just get me on Twitter. Just give me a message on Twitter, and then I'll be somewhere.
just go bat him. So we got that. Training Academy came around, you had the confidence boost of the Battle Royal and what have you. So I think it was Mr. P, your opponent on that show. So amazing hand. I love Mr. P. I think he's just amazing. And then you have the Christmas Chaos. So Training Academy, it's not a big crowd because it's not a big venue, but the Christmas Chaos show at Deanston is a pretty big crowd to have one of your first proper matches of Triple Threat, Omar and Archer. So obviously everyone knows who hears this rant. VIP is it just means everyone except the three people who didn't pay the extra £3. So it's a big crowd that you're in front of. They're actually here to see wrestling. It's not like Trinity Center where it could just be people that are walking by. Was there any nerves going into that match, particular match for you?
Oh, there was a lot of nerves. I think when it came around to the time where, I think I can't remember who entered first. I think it was Archer that entered first. I remember hearing his music, and I'm just like, okay. Try to keep it together. Try to keep it in together. It's kind of like the thing where it's like, this is actually real. It's not like a dream or a fantasy. Like I'm actually going out and performing and stuff. And then when my music plays, it's like, okay, it's time to, all right, time to get into the mindset and get going and just have fun, pretty much.
It was a hell of a match. From what I remember, there was blood, there was sweat, there was assuming tears at some point as well. So it's quite a chaotic first match, especially when it comes to you having. I mean, you had that five, four or five matches, and then you had the training academy. But going into a triple threat, I suppose, is a different beast entirely. Do you feel like that you were just thrown into the deep end going into a triple threat in front of a big crowd like that? Did it help? Did it hinder? How do you cope with pressure?
I think I just in the match I just like to stay calm and then just again just go out, have fun, and if anything happens, you just move on and you just move on and do something else pretty much.
That's it. I mean, it's been said to a lot of other podcasts that the only people that know you've made a mistake is the wrestlers. That's it. We don't know. So as long as you don't panic, it's fine. I'm just gonna sit in the crowd and go, oh, that was interesting. So from that point onwards, you went to fighting giants for whatever reason. Don't know if anyone's out to get you particularly, but you had matches with Brad Evans, Dino, and he's getting a lot of mentions with Murphy. And you had the Regal Rumble as well. So it's a lot of big guys you ended up coming up against. I don't know how. Again, this is all seems to be go back to the theme of trial by fire, but you were put in with a lot of big guys. Was that beneficial for you? Did you feel like you learned a lot from facing these big guys initially, or did you feel like someone was out to get you?
Personally, I felt like it. I mean, I learned a lot from it. That's just the best I can say, is because in the world of wrestling, there's gonna be like different types of people with different sizes and stuff. And yeah, it just taught me a lot about how to just pretty much try to get your head around. Okay, how do these guys do what they do in the ring? How do I try to outnumber them in a way? But I think what happened with Brad, Dino, and all that, it just didn't work. But to me, I think it just comes down to learning and just learning and all that type of stuff. Learning from mistakes type thing.
I mean, as someone who, like you said, you're a big fan of The Undertaker. You've seen plenty of matches where people have tried to take him down, like your Rey Mysterios or what have you. They've tried to chop down the beast. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. So when it comes to going into those kind of matches, you said you want to try and find a way to outnumber them and what have you. But was there any matches or wrestlers that you watched to try and pick up a style or some interest? I'm assuming that's a cat that's just went past.
Nah, that was just a random fly that's
Oh,
just
jeez.
flying around. Jeez, get away.
Oh. Right.
Did not
We'll
expect to
reset.
do that. Get away.
Oh, I was going to reset myself for a second. I mean, I'm not editing. I don't know why I need to reset myself. Yeah, so was there any matches or wrestlers that you watched in particular to help you kind of navigate going against bigger opponents?
I'm not quite sure, in all honesty. Yeah, I know, honestly, I really don't know. It's kind of a tough one.
Just any wrestlers in general that helps you with your style that you watch.
You see, I've been recommended like a couple of people. But I think the one that really helped out a lot, well, there's two, was 123 Kid and I think early to mid 2000s Rey Mysterio.
Okay. Yeah, I can definitely see where there's some 1-2-3 kid in there. That's Yeah, I can absolutely, now you've mentioned that, I'm like, yeah, okay, yeah, I can see where that's coming from. He's one of those guys, even when he was X-Pac as well, it's one of those guys where you go back and watch as an older person, you go, God, they were good. They were really good. And they didn't get the respect at the time, I don't think, because there was always the X-Pac heat kind of comments, but yeah, they're the race. Of course, a past guest at Aberdeen Anarchy as well, that's graced the Great Wrestle Zone. So yeah, so from that point was yeah. So when it comes to the shows itself, for WrestleZone, when you were training, were you part of the crew? Were you doing kind of ringside work? Or I can't say I noticed the ringside crew a lot of the times at the shows, I'll be honest. So I probably have crossed paths with you in the past. But yeah, it was again that learning experience that you're able to watch these shows. You can see what the audience is receptive to. You're always kind of logging at the back of your head, going, right, I think I can do this. Maybe see a Conor Malloy match and go, right, okay, they like this kind of thing. Was that always cogs always turning?
Yeah, pretty much. There was times where I would just be standing doing some security work. I would just pretty much take notes of what all the others we were doing, like what Conor Malloy and Evan Young does. And I think other times I would just be pretty much doing the camera work because I used to do a lot of that. I think I can't remember if it was. Yeah, it was definitely before COVID, and then once COVID came back on. No, not COVID came back on. Once the world started getting back together for Halloween hijinks, I think I was just doing staff work and pretty much something like that. Yeah.
I'm always fascinated by the. I'm going to go back through pictures and that. I'm probably going to see you just there with the camera then, doing the roving around the ring,
Yeah.
as you try not to bump into Brian, and Brian tries not to bump into you when he's doing the photos. That's always interesting to watch if the match is a little bit of a lull. So yeah, I'll probably go back and see if I can see you there. Anyway, right, more questions. But Kirsten sent loads, absolutely loads.
Oh,
So I've done Judas, done Ronan. I'm going to take a curveball here and go for Callum next, which I don't know if you're too old for this particular question, but I hope not. If Tommy is the black slash yellow ranger, Thunder is obviously the blue ranger, Mr. WrestleZone as the white slash sixth specialist ranger, who's the rest of the team? He's put me as the blue or Zordon. I'm not that old to be Zordon, but yeah. So do you know Power Rangers?
yeah, I know. I grew
Yes.
up with the like later seasons of Power Rangers. Sadly, like the Mystic Force and the SPDs. I will say I like Power Rangers SPD. I will like that. That's just the one I'll always
That's your
go
season,
to.
I think. Like
That's my season. That's my season of Power Rangers.
I was Mighty Morphin, but that's just because I'm ancient. But SPD is yours. Okay, so yeah, who's your Power Rangers team?
Oh God. So I'm the black and yellow. Thunder's blue. Mr. Athazone's the superior. Well,
That's the first time Mr.
I
Wrestling's
had
been
a
called superior.
for the green one. I either want to have either Evan Young because he has the green in his trunks, or Oliver Green because Oliver Green.
That makes sense. Tommy Oliver Green. Yep.
For red, oh God. Oh, that's a tough one. I mean, maybe Tucker, maybe. I don't know. If Scotty Swift was still here, then he would have been the Red Ranger. Absolutely. No problem with that. But yeah, that's pretty much it. Tucker for the Red Ranger and either Oliver Green or Evan Young for the Green Ranger.
Yeah, Aspen Pink, obviously. He's gonna be the Pink
Oh,
Ranger.
absolutely.
Yeah, so that's fine. I thought when I asked that question, you could be like, "Oh, I haven't watched Power Rangers," and I was just gonna shrivel up and just go, "No," because there's questions about Sonic coming up, and I haven't played Sonic since like I was 5 years old, so I'm gonna be lost when if you're explaining that at all. So
I'm
yeah,
not going
that's
to fanboy too much.
oh, you can fanboy as much as you want. There may be a case where people will watch the video and I'll be in the corner just looking confused and just going, I have no idea what's going on here. So from that point onwards, we'll finish off your kind of wrestling career-ish up to now, which was Anarchy, which is the ladder match, which is probably one of my favorite matches on the show. It was because it was just absolute chaos. You're probably one of the first. There's probably a very short list of folk that have went from debuting straight to the main card in Aberdeen, because a lot of debutants that year would have went to the pre-show or what have you. So again, when you found out you were going to be not only on the main show back at Dainston, where you had your first kind of official in front of a big audience match. You're back at Deanston, in a ladder match against, was it five other guys, including Zach Dynamite, who
Yeah.
you watched wrestle in one of your first shows, Willem Sterling, who you saw on your one of your first shows as well. Not that I'm trying to heap any more pressure because the time has passed, but was there a lot of, we look through it, you're like, oh my God, I'm actually going to be on the biggest show of their calendar, and I'm going to be in this big match as well. Was if the pressure wasn't already on, was it just amplified when you went through the actual logistics of the match?
Yeah, when I was first told that I'm going to be in the ladder match, I just pretty much I was like shocked. I was like sh really, really shocked. It's like, wait, my first Anarchy and I'm doing a ladder match? Oh God. But oh, because I think I was like really speechless at the time, because it's like I only had like a few matches on shows, and now I'm being thrown into a ladder match. Like, oh my God, it's going to be a challenge, but we'll see what happens. And I think when we got to Deanston, it was just mainly, all right, all right, how's this gonna work type thing? How am I going to, well, we'll see what we can see what we can do and all that type of stuff. And I was just like, oh God, I'm just looking around like the whole entire Deanston, and I'm just like, oh no. The nerves were definitely kicking in, like especially when it came time to when it came down to the match, because like, oh my God, it's actually happening. Okay, keep it cool. Like it was kind of like the thing where it's like I'm kind of losing my mind, but at the same time, it's like, okay, I'm looking forward to this. All right, I think we'll have. Okay, all right, I know what I'm doing. I know what I'm doing. That's good. Cool.
And I mean, it wasn't that much luck on the day because I think the ring, one of the wooden slats had moved before your match as well. So there was a big delay before you could actually get in the ring. So even if you did think that, you're like, oh my God, now it's delayed. Is this going to happen? I'm going to have to do stuff. I'm going to have to make do with that. But yeah, and also you're in with William Sterling, who's got a reputation for doing stupid things in a ladder match. Zach Dynamite, who's reputation for doing stupid things and weapons involved matches, but you got your moment though. You got a big dive from the top onto the outside as well. Again, it's just, was that a highlight for you so far in wrestling, or was that just a going right, I'm gonna do it, let's just get in there?
I think that was pretty much like a highlight. I'd say it was like a highlight. I mean, the only thing I don't like about that spot is that Logan Paul took it. I'm just not a fan of that.
Logan Paul
No need for
stealing
that.
content all the time. That's the reputation
Yeah.
that man has. So we'll go back into the questions then. Let's get the Sonic ones in, because I'll be
All right.
let's get me confused, and then I can recover for the rest of it. Kirsten, one of our many questions: are we getting Sonic themed Tommy Raiden merch at some point?
I'm working on it, let's just say that.
Okay, there you go.
Working
There's
on
an
it.
exclusive. I should also ask, wrestlers as Sonic characters. So
Oh no.
I'll throw in Bruiser Brad as Knuckles. That'll be my kind of, or maybe Dino as Knuckles.
I was thinking Caleb for Knuckles, in all honesty.
Yeah, maybe.
Something like that, maybe.
William is William Starling's Eggman, right?
Yeah, I'd say.
So
Sorry,
yeah.
William.
Who else? I don't know who else we've got. We've got Tails.
Oh, I'm trying to think of the tails. I don't know. Maybe Evan, I'm not quite sure. Shadow, I'm gonna throw this one in. Some people might disagree, but I'll go with Oliver Queen for Shadow the Hedgehog.
I can see it.
And
Yeah.
yeah. Who else have we got?
I've tapped out now. You've mentioned all the ones I've heard of, so
Yeah.
that's
There's like a lot of different characters, and I can just go, oh, he can be. Oh, wait, can he? No, maybe. Because I'm like those types of people that'll go, maybe. No. No. Nope.
But my knowledge of Sonic is quite lame when it comes to, it took me far too long to realize that Tails, his real name is Miles Per Hour. Miles Power. It took me way too long to realize that's Miles Per Hour, and I was embarrassed for myself at that point. So it's, yeah. So yeah, there's a couple of Sonic characters then. Any other throw-ins for Robotnik? I feel like I've just thrown William Sterling under the bus straight away, but he seems like the most Robotnik person I've ever met.
I mean, I think, would I maybe say? Oh God, I have no idea. There's like a lot of different opportunities for other people, but I mean, I think there are times why I would say maybe Tucker or Dawkins, but mainly down to personality, because sometimes when they act like that, it's like I get Robotnik vibes. Don't know why.
So we've got other questions from Kirsten, who also Oliver Green tried to poach onto it as well. Who is faster, you or Ollie? And he's
Me.
put, why is it him?
It's definitely me.
Has this been proven? Has there been a race? Has there been a foot race outside the academy?
No, I mean, I have given Oliver a message and he says, yeah, we'll definitely do it. And I'm like, okay. I don't hear anything back from him, but if there is a race, then you know where to find me. That's all I can say.
So Oliver
Definitely
Green's
be
scared.
definitely.
He's scared of you then. That's what I'm getting from there. He's scared of racing you because he knows.
Wouldn't say he's scared. I think there's just times where it's like, okay, I'm gonna back off a little bit because don't want this to go too out of hand. It's like I'll let things go whatever way can work.
Oliver's also asked, his other question is, how would you review Fife? And he heard the hash browns are good.
Oh God. I mean, in all honesty, I'd say it's like a six, it's a 5.5 out of 10 place.
No,
I
and
mean, some of the
a big fan of
places,
Fife, eh? No.
well, not a, I mean, it's like somewhere in the middle. Bloody fine. It's like somewhere in the middle. I mean, there's like, I think I went to a chipper though. Yeah, I went to a chipper in five. And there was like a Spider-Man on like one of the screens. I'm like, Spider-Man from the Tobey Maguire movies. Okay, that's pretty good. Getting myself a mince pie. Like mince pies, they're good. But I'd say, go oh God, I have no idea. There's like a lot of things I could say about Fife.
But you also wouldn't mind a booking in Fife, so you're kind of just trying to weigh it up at the same time.
I mean. In all honesty, I wouldn't mind it if there's someone reaching out or something like that, then absolutely I'd happily take the booking. Just like hearing all the five stories are absolutely amazing.
It's a beautiful kingdom, apparently. I've never been, and we'll leave it at that. So yeah, I'm sure. I mean, I've heard the wrestling's good though. We'll leave it at that. Mince pie though, that's a bold choice for a chipper. Is that always your chipper order or?
That's always my chip order. I always go to get like a mince pie. They're absolutely lovely.
That's if it's not battered, I find
Yeah.
it pointless,
I
but.
remember there used to be a chipper somewhere close to where I live. It's like, okay, these are just amazing. And then they changed it, and I'm like, this mince pie is terrible. Who cooked this? So I'm like, I'm not going back there anymore because they're no, just no.
It's the ones where they change the pastry because I like just your standard kind of, I don't know, cup kind of thing, kind of pastry, but then they start
Absolutely.
throwing this flaky stuff on top, and I'm like, it's just no. That's a mince
Yeah.
pie round. That's you need it for that, but not for an individual mince pie. That's just weird. Pucker pies, yeah, they can get in the bin. You know those kind of things. Ugh. Didn't think I'd end up in mince pie chat here, but here we are. We do have a comment on Instagram, so it's not so much of a question. It's from Jan the Slavic one. He's put in, I just want to mention that this guy is fantastic, and I hope one day we will work together on a show. There you
That's amazing.
go. Old Jan. I'm sure it was Jan. It wasn't Stan that was dealing with that. But we had Jan on a couple of weeks ago in back end of last season. So he's very passionate in the wrestling. How aware are you of this kind of wider Scottish wrestling scene? Do you keep an eye on things? Do you try to watch things like from down in Glasgow way, or do you try to keep yourself focused on where you're at just now in WrestleZone?
Well, I pretty much know. I've pretty much been told a couple of stories about different types of promotions. It's some of it's interesting. Some of it's like, I'm not quite sure about that place. Like I've heard of the FCWs and the W3Ls, and they seem pretty much somewhere I'd like to possibly jump onto shows and then just wrestle and stuff like that. But I think companies like ICW, maybe I'm not quite sure, but I think the ones that I would possibly be looking at for the future is FCW and W3L, something I could be looking on for the future.
All right, okay, so that's really good choices, and they're fairly local as well, for you, so as far as Perth and Dundee could be from there, and W3L is, of course, Fife at times, and I'll be at a show as of recording tomorrow, so that's the co-op to Elgin, so it's bold choices. I mean, I thought like Discovery as well. Assuming it's not always in the forefront, because
Oh,
I know a lot.
Discovery, that was another one I forgot to say. I totally forgot to mention Discovery. I should be ashamed.
But yeah, so I mean, we're kind of lucky. There is companies, of course, that we don't feature that are probably a bit, but yeah, so you're quite keen to. You do your research, kind of thing. If there's a company you want to go to, you check who's on it, what they do, any reputation, that kind of thing. So you are you're not taking a booking for a booking's sake, kind of thing. You're Okay, cool.
Just mainly in it to have fun and just get just the love and the passion, pretty much.
So we've got another question from Kirsten, which I'll get to in a second, but we do have one from Instagram from the Soul Sessions, which I've realized I can't say, so that's great. He's asked if you could become a tag team champion with any wrestler in the world, which wrestler?
Oh, that's a good question. I mean, I would say Oliver Green, in all honesty, because I speak to Oliver like all the time, and then we randomly like play with the idea saying, what if we became a tag team? It's like, oh, that could be pretty cool. I'd be interested in that. But if it were to be anywhere in or around Scotland, oh God, that's a good one.
I was going to try and caveat of anyone active, because I thought you'd go Undertaker first. Go bring Undertaker back. I'll be tag team. He only held it with Big Show and Kane. Let's throw another one in there.
I only say this because I'm just gonna say this, but I might if he's still wrestling, then maybe X-Pac. I'd like to try a tag team with X-Pac.
That'd be cool. I'd love to see X-Pac back up and up here, because he was great in that one match that he had up here. So it'd be cool. You never know. It's one of those things where the WrestleZone, especially for Aberdeen Anarchy, when they had guests, they were fairly, you could never guess. That was always the best thing about them. So never know. X-Pac, bring X-Pac back, get a tag team going. It's not unheard of. We had Jay Lethal as a tag team champion in WrestleZone. So, not outside the realms of possibility. Kirsten's also asked, where do you want to see yourself in 1/5/10 years time within wrestling, and do you have any long-term goals or plans within wrestling?
Well, I think the biggest goal right now is just to get in better shape because I think recently I've started planning out like different diets and all that type of stuff. So just so I can figure out, okay, what types of protein and all that do I need? I need to find a gym as well. There have been times where I think last year before I was on shows, I'd reached out to someone to give me a hand, but the problem is like it just keep like the expenses and all that were a bit too much because I'm paying for quite a lot of things right now, and also just with like different schedules and stuff. But my main goal is just to get a better physique, all that type of stuff. And in terms of wrestling, just pretty much possibly wrestling across Scotland. That's like a big goal I'd like to do.
Yeah, I mean, it's really great now to see that before, when you started watching WrestleZone or being involved in wrestling, they were kind of just in that little corner, in that pocket of Scotland, and now you're getting to see guys like the Foundation of the Future and Ronan King and Conor Malloy, and they're all kind of expanding themselves into across the country, and even some into England and Europe. So it's one of those things where it's the I suppose the only thing that's stopping you is your imagination when it comes to wrestling. So, 1 year, 5 years, 10 years, you could be Tommy Raiden champion somewhere, whether it's up here or not. We do have a bunch of two questions that we ask everyone. Don't know if you've been made aware of these two particular questions that we ask everyone. If not, I apologize in advance. First one we ask people is, what's your favorite dinosaur?
Oh God. I'm gonna have to go with the generic answer of being a T-Rex. That's it.
See, as someone as a Power Rangers fan, I thought you might have thrown in some lore for Mighty Morphin, but it's okay. It's fine. T-Rex is a fine answer.
I mean, I'm trying to get into Power Rangers lore, but yeah, I think it just comes to, okay, is this my type of style? Is that which Power Rangers show do I really like the most? Which shows do I not really like? Because I remember watching Samurai, and Samurai is like, it's fine. It's just there. It's there. But Mighty Morphin's like a big one I need to try to look into. Even the Mighty Morphin movie, if that's any good, because I heard some people it's good, say it's good, and other people say it's not, but I don't know.
I haven't watched it in a long time, I'll be perfectly honest. But for what I remember, it was amazing. But when it came out, I was like 12. So of course it was. It was the best thing going. So yeah. The once a ranger, always a ranger thing, once and always it came out on Netflix. Oh my God, I cried. Because that is my era of Power Rangers. How did we end up back here? Anyway, Power Rangers. So other question we ask everyone is, what would win in a fight? Two sheep or one cow?
Oh God. I'm gonna have to go with I'm gonna have to go with one cow. Honestly, I could get it wrong, but that's just the way I'm going.
It's entirely up to opinion. I will only judge you silently on your answers. So it's fine. It's cow number one for the cows. Anyway, right. So that's our silly questions out of the way. So when this comes out, it'll be August 9th. It'll be after Battle of the Nations. I don't know, in the next week or so you'll have a match announced. I don't know. You don't need to tell me. So it's fine. So when it comes to your Kirsten asked about your 1 year, 5 years, 10 years. Is there anyone on the roster right now at WrestleZone or in Scotland in general that you want to get in the ring with that you think would complement your style, or just someone that you want to share a ring with? I assume Oliver Green will be one. Anyone else?
Yeah, Oliver Green's definitely one. I'd like to try and get into the ring with I'd say that's a good one. I'm just gonna throw a couple of names out because there's like so many choices. Like I can like go on for ages about like the amount of people I'd love to face. But if I had to throw any like names in particular, I would go with Caleb's one, and I'm trying to think of another one who could work. You know, I'll throw Stanislav in there. Why not?
When are we going to get Thunder Lightning as a team?
I have no idea. I'm gonna give Thunder a message, but I'm not gonna take time out of this day. So if he has like an idea or anything like that, then you know where to find me.
The gala shows on. We've had Connor and Vago make some teams and what have you. I need Thunder Lightning somehow as a team. I've wanted it for a long time, or at least some sort of color coded team with yourself and Oliver Green and Blue Thunder, and just have them all together, like a Power Rangers team, I suppose. If Scotty Swift can manage you, it's fine. It's all good. I think he'd end up with two managers because Blue Thunder just prefers not to wrestle. So that's there you go. That's a t that's ideas, guys. I'm just throwing them at you, WrestleZone. You just take them and run with them.
Just have us with Power Rangers like phones and then just doing like the big hand
Ah,
movements saying Power Rangers, go, go, go.
that's it. That's the promo. That's the video. This will be Titantron they have on the side. It's you guys at the start just going thunder or lightning, and then just like I don't know what era you're on with did the beeping or something like that. Just turn into superheroes. This is excellent. This is wonderful stuff. We'll write this down for our future. Okay, so far you've had a few matches with big guys, and the guys that you've picked, Caleb being one of them. So you're not fear of facing humongous opponents. Is there any match so far that's been a particular favorite, or a venue so far that you've felt that you've really enjoyed wrestling in your journey so far?
I'm gonna have to say it's kind of like a one answer type thing. It would just always be that ladder match in Dainston, just as like the I just like the atmosphere from Dainston, and that ladder match was just so fun. Just like just blew me away the whole entire match. It's like, oh my God, just I was able to almost get the contract, but just climb up the ladder. It's like, oh my God, this is actually real. Oh God.
It's ladder matches, like when you watch it from the outside, sometimes they're like just very slowly climbing up. It's one of those things where you didn't really understand why wrestlers did that until you actually started doing it and going, oh God, I actually take my time doing this. There's that much moving about. I need to actually figure out everything before I take each step. Was that something you didn't quite expect when it came to ladder match?
Yeah, I think it when it came to the ladder match, it's like, okay, we've got some ladders. So we've got some ladders in the training academy. So I just wanted to see what it feels like when you climb up the ladder, like getting used to the heights and something like that. When I tried it the first time, I was like, oh God, that's kind of a challenge, that one. But yeah, it just mainly came down to just doing a lot of training and just making sure what I'm doing with the ladder just makes sense, pretty much.
Excellent. So yeah, I think we've covered your journey so far in the world of professional wrestling. We've got some great questions in that we've been able to ask as well. Is there anything that we haven't spoken about, or anything that you want to declare your passion for outside of Sonic, that we haven't brought up that you'd like to share?
No, not really.
I'd keep Tommy
I was
Raiden to
gonna say
Tommy
a
Raiden.
different answer.
Oh yeah, actually, mention of Tommy Raiden. So Raiden, of course, being a thunder-based or lightning-based character in Mortal Kombat, was that a conscious decision for Tommy Raiden, or was that just a sheer coincidence?
Don't know if I actually remember getting there was like some comments on the wrestling Facebook whenever I had matches, and someone always put down Mortal Kombat GIFs, and then this might actually make them go, oh, what, Tommy, what the heck? It's the fact that I'm not a big Mortal Kombat fan, so that name just stuck with me randomly. It was like, I like that name, so what does the name Raiden mean? I'll look up the name, and I'm like, okay, there we go, that's my character.
That's why I mean, sometimes I thought it was all conscious thought. When Raiden, of course, thunder, lightning. That obviously always makes sense. But no, it's just I love that. I love it. It was just a circuit happenstance that it actually all lined up a little bit there for you. Excellent. Well, thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me today. Like I say, this is going to come out after Battle of the Nations. So if you've got a match, we'll just say you've won. Congratulations. If you haven't, then makes this a bit awkward. So where can people find out more about Lightning Bolt Tommy Raiden on social media?
Well, you can find me at my Twitter. Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook is just where you need to find me, just under Tommy Raiden.
I know your Twitter handle because I've got it in front of me. Is at Lightbolt TR45. Nice and memorable.
Yes, that's the one.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much for speaking to me today, and hope, like I say, hope you next time we speak, we'll have a little bit more about a bit more wrestling. You'll have a title, hopefully, and
Hopefully.
I'll see you nations, probably.
All right then. All
Right, have a good one.
right then, have a good one.